So, look, I'm a very obedient person, and I was asked to think, what is secondary education for? And I've been thinking about it a lot for this, but also I've just finished a book, which I'm delivering on Friday, called Life Lessons, The Case for a National Education Service. And what that is really about is I agree with, I think we are in crisis. I think our system is in crisis. But it's a difficult word to use when schools are so important and teachers are doing such a good job. But I think we need to do something radically different. And the Labour Party has talked about a National Education Service, but perhaps not fleshed it out as much as it could, she said tactfully. So I thought that I would try and set down what I thought a National Education Service might do. So some of my thoughts here arise from all the thinking that I've been doing for that work. So what I want to do tonight are, I want to do three things. Firstly, I'd like to speculate a little about the future, as the invitation to this talk suggests. I think Anthony has just finished a book on the Fourth Industrial Revolution. We'll talk a great deal more about this. But I just want to talk a little about what that Fourth Industrial Revolution might mean, the coming of robots, the incredible reach of artificial intelligence, and changes to the economy. Secondly, I want to consider some of the key functions, what I think should be the key functions of secondary education in the immediate period. But thirdly, towards the end, I want to take what I would call a more grounded social and political view of what secondary education is for and what it could be in what remains of the 21st century. We keep talking about the 21st century, we are actually quite well into it now. And why do I want to talk about the political and social aspects? Because both history and our present situation tells us really very clearly that whatever the theories, whatever the exciting ideas that abound, and there's always exciting ideas around education, our system has always served and continues to serve some children far better than others. So to me, the real challenge to secondary education and for it is to educate all children and all students, all pupils, they're not really children in secondary school, but to educate all young people in the richest and most meaningful way possible. And as I say, I think as a nation we failed to do that, and we will continue to fail to do that unless we make some quite radical changes, which I'll touch on at the end. So just on the future challenges, the technology. It's obvious technology is already playing quite a big part in our education system, and it will continue to do so. I was at a conference recently of head teachers where a company called Lifter gave us a demonstration of, I don't know if you call it an app or a program, which is now available to all schools, that allows students to access what they call immersive story worlds. And maybe some people have only been here who's in secondary schools, now maybe they've got access to it. But I think it's quite incredible what these programs can do. So what you do is you have a 360 degree experience of, for instance, going behind, I don't know why it's Finland, but the Finnish opera and ballet, going through everything from the making of costumes through to the putting on of productions and so on. On another program, they share recipes and sort of the act of eating rituals with communities and families around the world. And then in another program, they visit and hear stories from the unusually vibrant, self-governing Ethiopian community. And, you know, one can read about all these things. We could read about how the Finnish opera works or the ballet. We could read about the Ethiopian village, but to be able to see it projected up onto a wall in a class, and the colours of this program, this tool, were just sort of incredible. So that to me seems a highly positive use of the new technology, and students will be able in the future to take a tour of everything from world famous museums to the inside of the human body without leaving their desks. The whole question of robots. I don't really know what to say meaningfully to you about robots. Robots are here, they're going to be in classrooms, they're going to be in call centres, they're going to be, you know, everywhere in our society, but human beings are going to have to run them and administer them and supervise them. And I noticed today that Elon Musk, who creates the electric car, he had a target to create 3,000 electric cars a week, and something went wrong with all the robots who were doing that. And he said, we've underestimated the role of the human in the fourth industrial revolution. There's also the question of driverless cars. I mean, I think there will always be a need for an underground service of cars driven by what I think of as surly, well-informed drivers who drive at the moment when I take taxis. I always think taxi drivers are the most well-informed people. And I think most of us are not going to trust those for a long time. And even those who are putting out driverless cars are saying that you need a human being to be aware of context in order to judge what's happening on the road. Other aspects of the new revolution ahead of us is MOOCs, massive open online courses, which some people are already using in Leeds, a sort of pick and mix approach to doing a degree. I think what MOOCs enable is really determine students to theoretically complete degrees without ever leaving their homes. But the truth is that generally, most people give up. They start one and they don't proceed. And that's because, to come on to my second point, that even with the rapid growth in technology, the human being and human relations, ungovernable as both of those things are, is going to become more important, I would argue. I'd be interested to see whether Anthony agrees with me. So they'll be needed to make key decisions in the way that I described. But at a more profound level, there was a really interesting essay in The Guardian last week about an expert in robotic techniques and an early years learning specialist who had a baby. And they thought, let's see what all our knowledge of programming and robots can do to help our child develop. And what they quickly realised was that it couldn't, and that actually you need the emotional and relational aspect of parenting or care to create a flourishing human being. And one can see that in all sorts of ways. Early years specialists say that it's a child needs to have a sense of being and belonging in order to learn. University teachers, I've heard say that you can do lots of things online, but to truly develop and deepen ideas and understanding, one probably needs to be and would want to be in dialogue with a student. So that's the second element, that the human being is going to remain essential. And the third is that we are going to live longer. And that's going to change the place and function of secondary education. Most of us, I think most of us here who live in central London and have a reasonable diet, will probably live now to our mid to late 80s. And more of us will live to 100. I mean, these things have a regional and class element. But that does shift the overall place of secondary education in the chronology of the life. So it becomes less of a defining moment, it becomes more of a defining start, with ideally education and retraining available throughout life. And one of the messes that politicians have made of our education system in the last 30 years in particular is the cutting back of further and adult education in a really dramatic way. And it's just crazy. It doesn't make economic sense. It doesn't make human sense. So we're coming on to what should people learn at school. I quite like this Buckminster Fuller quote, which is people should go back to school and think about whatever it was they were thinking about before somebody came along and told them that they had to earn a living. Well, that's a pretty good quote. So I think our education system is that we're going to have more time. There are people who argue, I don't know if any of you have read Utopia for Realists, which is very easy to read, but by somebody called Rutger Bregman. But he's an advocate of the basic, universal basic income, which is becoming more and more seriously considered. It's pioneered in various places in the world. And the idea that we would all be given 10,000 a year and we could do what we wish with it, which would then mean we'd have to fill our time doing what Buckminster Fuller says. And what we're going to fill our time doing? We're going to do what human beings have always done. We're going to read, we're going to talk, we're going to cook, we're going to fall in love, we're going to have sex, we're going to look at the stars. We're going to play music, well or badly. And clearly, secondary education is going to be something that will help us to do all of those things. Perhaps not have sex, but perhaps it will, but in a more, what's the word, safer and responsible fashion. So now I want to talk about some of the capabilities that I think it's essential for young people to acquire. So I'm not going to talk about, you know, what should be in the curriculum and things like that. I'm going to talk about six capabilities that I think secondary education should begin to help us to acquire. The first is acquiring knowledge, yes, but just as importantly, and I think this is absolutely key, is that secondary school and primary should help us to learn how to love learning. Because if we don't love the process of learning, when we leave school, we will want to leave it behind. We may be lucky and come upon it later. So every subject, English literature, history, physics, music, religious studies, is as interesting as the human being who teaches it or the way it's taught. I mean, you mentioned this. One of the problems of our current system is its aridity. It's become much too tick-box, much too fact-driven. I know the arguments for why it should be like that, the knowledge curriculum, the belief of, you know, particularly Michael Gove and Nick Gibb, who's still Minister of State in the department, that particularly disadvantaged young people need a body of knowledge in order to develop and access further knowledge and be full citizens. But, you know, I visited a famous school, I won't name it, but it's a school much praised by politicians, which is taking this approach. In the classroom, I went into the classroom, there were hanging cards that just had the three things, well, there were lots of things, but what the students needed to know. It was fantastically sterile, I have to say. And I think there's also sterile behaviour policies that go with that, because I think learning about relationships is a key part of secondary education. So in contrast to this sort of fact-driven tick-box approach, there are schools, and I often get invited to see them because I write about a different approach. They're schools that they're bucking the sort of league table Ofsted trend, and they're trying to keep education interesting and joyful. And what's so interesting to me about the schools I visit is that very often they are schools in very deprived areas, schools that would be called in effect secondary moderns. But they're doing fantastic work, which convinces me that, you know, we could have this approach across all the schools, because it would be even easier to put into practice with high achieving, better off children, because education is easier when you're dealing with that cohort. So I've seen some really pioneering work in terms of curriculum design, with students helping to design the curriculum, which is an idea that comes from an earlier period. Mixing academic and practical learning, because of course in this country we're so snobbish about practical learning, we're so snobbish about vocational education, in fact we're so snobbish about it, we haven't even managed to create a proper vocational system. You know, Alison Wolfe, who has done two reports on vocational education for the government, both of them saying it's the system is in tatters. And so I really don't know what the government's doing about that. And also these schools promote student reflection on learning and confidence. And there are important movements in education that that concentrate on process as much as on outcome. I recommend you, if you're interested, to look up the Learning Without Limits project, which I think will define the future, probably later into the 21st century, which completely rejects fixed stability thinking. And it says you shouldn't label the learner, you should have all learners together concentrating on what they are learning. There's the slow education movement, which combines traditional methods with a more hands-on approach to acquiring knowledge, with students doing their own research, working in groups collaboratively, using the new technology to communicate with others outside the school who have more expert knowledge on whatever they're working on. And Mike Grenier, who's a teacher at Eton and is part of the Slow Education Network, describes it like this, and I think it's interesting. To achieve mastery of a subject requires time to learn, but also time to reflect on how learning has happened. Many simple tests, forms of assignment, largely remove any thinking and simply become tests of memory. The so-called traditionists rail against skills as if they're somehow nebulous and examples of lazy thinkers, and the so-called progressives see knowledge as damaging to creativity. I'm not sure that's true, but I'll let him say it. And of no lasting significance. Both positions are incorrect. According to Mike Renier, quote, the more nuanced synthesis of thinking and learning that's the heart of slow education is hard to implement in a culture of fast food learning, in which measurement becomes paramount. And we have a system in which data is paramount. So that's the first, learning how to love to learn. Secondly, learning how to talk seems to me a really important part of the educative process, particularly important for adolescents, and I think particularly important for students from poorer homes and for girls. I've written a book called What Should We Tell Our Daughters, and I went and looked in detail at how many young women kind of disappear into themselves in a public sense when they go through adolescence. You could call it a loss of confidence, but actually they know what they think and they know what they feel and they will speak about it among themselves, but public arenas don't suit them. So I think we need to teach everyone to learn how to talk. And I don't mean in a sort of Boris Johnson debating Oxford Union way, I mean ordinary talk. So there's now, again, terrifically interesting movements within state education called the Oracy Movement, like literacy. And I've seen some amazing examples of students. I mean, you do get some who could rival Boris Johnson at 13. You know, some people just have a talent for standing up and talking. I think most people don't. But just, I think the more you speak what you know, and you speak your uncertainty, and you speak your ambivalence, the better the educative process goes. Oh gosh, right, that is really, okay. So, I will now have to really speed up. Developing a love of the arts is terribly important. That's been cut back by government. Learning how to believe the best of oneself and one's capabilities. And again, this is high expectations. It's not about data and destination, the Russell Group or Oxbridge or A-Stars. It's about learning how to trust yourself and to believe in yourself. 2 points, in the 60s and 70s, black parents, the point I was going to say, it's very easy for us to underestimate children, often out of deep prejudice. 60s and 70s, black parents started up supplementary schools because lots of young black students were being excluded or considered to have behavioural problems because of racism in the schools. It's taken a long time to believe that girls are capable and there's still a long way to go. Learning how to be oneself, manage one's emotions. Personally, I think it takes a lifetime to learn how to be yourself. Takes a lifetime to learn to manage your emotions, but you could start at school, and Anthony made a pioneer of that. Learning to be part of society. Just give me 2 minutes, because it's my final point. So there's two parts of learning to be part of society. Students taking part in the government of schools, helping to run schools. Very important. If you want people to be local councillors, teach them what making decisions is about. Teach them to learn how to defend them. But the other part of it is how important that we all go to school together. So this brings me to my few final words. What is secondary education for? That question, where did you go to school, is still a question people ask, and it's still a question whose answer matters. Even after 75 years of state secondary provision, only this weekend the Financial Times reported on a data map available only to people who went to private schools. Now, the FT thought it was a ridiculous idea, but there is still that strong view that where you go to school is still defines your class position. And I think we need to move towards and have a big debate about how we have a universal integrated system. Now, I know every country has its own DNA and its own history, but Finland and Canada are examples of places where all young people go to school together in the private sector is a luxury part, not a kind of significant and competing and problematic part of a hierarchy. And that's what I would really like to see, and I'm sure Anthony agrees with me in theory and in practice, but it might certainly be difficult to do it. But I think one of the things we need to do, people say private education is too expensive. I think private education is too cheap, because I think the state subsidises it too much. And I think if we remove state subsidy, and if we put VAT on the school fees, and we redirected that at the time of austerity to the schools around the country that really need resources, I think it would help actually to integrate the system in many important ways. I've got lots of other ideas, but as usual, can't get to the end of quite what I'm going to say, but I've said most of it. Thank you.
Thank you.